الصوارم كي تسترد المظالم حتى الأراضي نسام.
هذه القدس على الأرض لتبكي وعراب العز قد أمس تهيئا.
الله أكبر.
What is actually going to stop you preaching? What you don't have to do just stop you. Don't you agree? Is that going to stop us?
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
الله ولي الذين آمنوا يخرجهم من الظلمات إلى النور والذين كفروا أولياؤهم الطاغوت يخرجونهم من النور إلى الظلمات أولئك أصحاب النار هم فيها خالدون.
Monsieur le Président, nous sommes vraiment rassurés par votre arrivée à la tête de la Fondation. Et je pense que ça va aussi assurer ceux qui contestaient la présidence de Monsieur le ministre Samper Sebenman, nos musulmans, à la tête de la Fondation. Et votre feuille de route aussi et votre engagement personnel nous rassurent une fois de plus. Bien, il y a certains propos relatifs au hijab ou au dialab qui circulent actuellement dans les réseaux sociaux, dont l'auteur, on vous le prête, que vous disiez que le dialab détruit la dignité de la femme musulmane. Vraiment, c'est des propos qui nous a un peu, qui s'étaient de trouble dans notre esprit. Et nous voulons vous donner l'occasion devant le public et nous voulons aussi profiter de cette occasion pour vous poser directement cette question. Est-ce que ce propos vient de vous en tant que président de la Fondation ou bien c'est des avis personnels en tant que musulman ou bien ce sont des propos qu'on vous a prêtés mais qui ne viennent pas de vous. Merci.
Bien. Ça arrive comme dernière question, prenons quelques temps en trois points. Le premier point, j'ai le profond respect, scrupuleux, la tendresse, l'amitié, et si elles me le permettent, l'affection et l'amour des femmes musulmanes ici présentes qui pensent qu'elles doivent médiatiser leur relation à Dieu et leur spiritualité par le voile ou le hijab. Je ne m'autoriserai jamais à dire à l'une ou à l'autre tu te voiles ou tu ne te voiles pas, parce que ce serait une violation de la conscience de l'une ou l'autre. Je ne me le permettrai jamais. D'ailleurs, c'est bien, vous m'avez donné l'occasion de préciser quelque chose. Le deuxième point, ma conviction profonde comme homme et comme homme de foi, c'est que cette affaire-là n'est pas si nécessaire pour compromettre et la scolarité et le travail et la... Parce que je rêve de voir mes compatriotes corélégionnaires femmes dans la haute administration. Je rêve de les voir directrices de centres hospitalo-universitaires. Je rêve de les voir rectrices d'académie. Je rêve de les voir conduire la diplomatie française. Je rêve de les voir ambassadrices. Je rêve de les voir préfètes de la République. Alors on me dira, oui, mais c'est la société qui porte un regard sur elles et c'est pour ça qu'elles sont jetées. Eh bien, De mon point de vue, ce n'est pas si nécessaire. De mon point de vue, je ne relativise qu'à ma petite personne, ce n'est pas si nécessaire pour compromettre l'avenir, le bonheur, l'épanouissement de nos corrélégionnaires femmes. Je ne l'ai pas dit, c'est dans un autre contexte, etc. Je ne suis pas homme à me dire « Ah oui, mais on a mal compris mes propos. » Le troisième point, s'il y a une raison pour laquelle la Fondation existe, c'est pour que nous puissions avoir des débats. J'ai toujours pensé, je l'ai toujours dit, je ne l'ai jamais caché, depuis les histoires des fillettes à peine nubiles qu'on a emmitouflées à Creil, si on avait la sagesse de dire non, les injonctions nombreuses et impérieuses dans la révélation coranique quant à l'acquisition du savoir ne sont pas le fait d'emmitoufler des fillettes. Nous ne serions pas arrivés à ça. Je peux témoigner comme homme que cette affaire du voilement des filles a été réglée au lendemain du recouvrement des indépendances de quasiment tous les pays musulmans. Ça n'a jamais été un problème. Jamais. Je peux en témoigner. Vous n'allez pas m'obliger à dire ou à faire quelque chose auquel je ne crois pas. Je pense qu'il y a lieu de voir ça. Donc, de deux choses l'une. Respect absolu pour les choix métaphysiques, spirituels des uns et des autres, sans aucun stigmate. Et je ne m'autoriserai jamais à entrer par infraction dans la conscience des uns et des autres, et notamment des unes et des autres. Et je répète, encore une fois, la tendresse et l'amitié que j'ai pour Hanan, et que j'ai pour telle ou telle fille, et j'en ai aussi des amis, ce n'est pas pour, comme alibi. En même temps, sans être macronien, en même temps, je trouve aussi qu'il y a eu un travail de culpabilisation de ces consciences. Et on ne peut pas continuer comme ça. Je ne veux pas dire que la Fondation doit prendre position là-dessus, ce n'est pas son rôle. Donc je ne mêlerai pas la Fondation là-dessus. Je dis simplement que ce qui me paraît être important, c'est le fait de voir quel est le plus important. On me dit, mais c'est dans la référence scripturaire coranique, c'est dans le Coran. Très bien. Il y a aussi qu'il faut couper la main du voleur dans le Coran. On ne la coupe plus, sinon c'est de la barbarie. On applique une chose, on n'applique pas une autre. Qu'est-ce que c'est que ce choix sélectif de l'observance de la norme religieuse? Voilà, je dis ce que je pense être juste de dire, rien d'autre. Ouvrons des débats, trouvons les espaces du discernement, de l'intelligence, de la confrontation des idées. Ouvrons ça et on trouvera sûrement des solutions. Au lieu du déchaînement du torrent d'injures, j'allais me taire, mais je le dis, des menaces de mort. Je suis un homme croyant. Si je devais quitter ce monde aujourd'hui, je le quitterais aujourd'hui. Conformément à mes convictions, dans le bien de ce que je crois être, en le révisant, parce que je ne fais pas de dogmatisme, bon pour l'homme, pour le sujet humain. C'est tout. Qu'est-ce que j'ai à gagner dans cette affaire? Je serais bien tranquille chez moi, si ce n'est qu'à un moment donné, nous ne pouvons pas rester silencieux ou inactifs de ce qu'on dénonce par ailleurs. Il y a lieu de s'engager. Et parlons, discutons, débattons, allons-y. Je vais où on souhaite que j'aille pour parler. Allons-y. Je crois l'avoir dit là ou je ne sais plus à qui. Vous voyez bien le spectre entre l'apostat mécréant et le dissimulateur qui veut saper la nation française. Eh bien, c'est qu'on me prête beaucoup de choses. Pour ce qui concerne l'apostasie, je ne me sens pas obligé de le dire, mais je le dis. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا رسول الله. Je suis pas obligé de le dire, je le dis. Et aucune force au monde ne me l'enlèvera, parce que je le crois fondamentalement, c'est gravé dans mon cœur. Alors, ceux qui disent qu'un tel est un apostat, c'est un mécréant, parce que sa langue a fourché. Eh bien, où est allé le verset coranique ? La bonne action et la mauvaise ne sauraient aller de pair. Rends le bien pour le mal et tu verras celui dont une inimitié te séparait de lui se transformer en ami et protecteur chaleureux. Mais n'y parvient que celui qui sait faire preuve d'une grande patience et n'y parvient que celui qui est siège d'une grâce infinie. Fin de citation du verset. Tiens, ça on l'oublie. On oublie toute la sourate. Par le temps, l'homme est assurément en déperdition. Et ceux qui s'enjoignent à la vérité, ceux qui s'enjoignent à la patience, sont ceux-là qui seront, j'allais dire, sauvés de leur déperdition. C'est dans notre tradition. Est-ce que vous pensez un instant que c'est agréable de subir ce qu'on subit s'il n'y avait pas derrière une volonté, si j'ose dire, d'amour, d'affection et de tendresse pour que mes sœurs, mes filles, si j'en avais davantage, puissent vivre sans être ostracisées. L'idéal eût été que ce ne soit pas le cas, bien entendu. Mais c'est le cas. Qu'est-ce qu'on fait ? On s'arc-boute ? Alors qu'on n'a même pas la majorité au Parlement. On va finir par légiférer. Et on aura Marine Le Pen et sa nièce. Vous voulez ça ? Alors si c'est non, un peu de sagesse, un peu d'intelligence, un peu de spiritualité, ou beaucoup même, un peu de connaissance, ou beaucoup même, un peu de science, ou beaucoup même. Est-ce que toute la période des années 20-30, depuis que Houda Sharawi a enlevé son voile, jusqu'à la révolution de Khomeini, est-ce que toute cette période, et surtout au lendemain du recouvrement des indépendances, est-ce que ces filles-là et ces femmes-là vont périr par le feu de l'enfer ? Jamais, je ne le crois pas en tout cas. De grâce, ouvrons les yeux. Vous savez, l'homme impavide et placide que je suis peut se révéler par moments un homme passionné. Donc voilà, on finit là-dessus.
وقل للمؤمنات يغضضن من أبصارهن ويحفظن فروجهن ولا يبدين زينتهن إلا ما ظهر منها وليضربن بخمرهن على جيوبهن ولا يبدين زينتهن إلا لبعولتهن أو آبائهن أو آباء بعولتهن أو أبنائهن أو أبناء بعولتهن أمهاتهن أو إخوانهن أو بني إخوانهن أو بني أخواتهن أو نسائهن أو ما ملكت أيمانهن أو التابعين غير أولي الإربة من الرجال أو الطفل الذين لم يظهروا على عورات النساء ولا يضربن بأرجلهن ليعلم ما يخفين من زينتهن وتوبوا إلى الله جميعا أيها المؤمنون لعلكم تفلحون
يا أيها النبي قل لأزواجك وبناتك ونساء المؤمنين يدنين عليهن من جلابيبهن ذلك أدنى أن يعرفن فلا يؤذين وكان الله غفورا رحيما
Tant qu'on satisfait Dieu, c'est ça le plus important pour nous. Le regard des autres, c'est pas le plus important. Ils seront pas là le jour qu'on va mourir. Ils seront pas là le jour de la résurrection, quand on sera tous devant notre Seigneur.
أسمعيني يا أخي صرخة النفس الأبية أسمعيني العز شدوى يطلب النفس الشجية أسمعيني يا أخي صرخة النفس الأبية
Il a tout de suite basculé sur des propos racistes, à savoir, il m'a dit « sale terroriste, sale arabe, sale musulmane », tout ça en me tirant mon voile, donc en me le tirant vers l'avant, il a réussi à me l'enlever à moitié. Donc moi, à ce moment-là, j'ai commencé à crier,
il continue.
لست أرض العيش عيش الهامجية
العيش عيش الهامجية
Est-ce que vous voulez que je vous contrôle ? Donc j'ai répondu, écoutez, si vous voulez me contrôler, contrôlez-moi, il n'y a aucun problème.
But anyways, today we're taught to be against segregation before in support of all forms of liberation. To free yourself from the clothes that only lead to your degradation. Why do you gotta cover your face for? We gotta see your identification. But little do they know her identity's right there. A woman who fears Allah and commits to her religious obligations.
So they say a Muslim woman is oppressed.
Avec mon vêtement, moi je suis heureuse. Moi c'est mon bonheur. C'est mon bonheur. Je fais de mal à personne. Je n'agresse personne, je ne critique personne.
Let's find the facts. And those who are calling for the freedom of women.
C'est peut-être une prison au regard des autres. Mais en réalité, je ne me suis jamais sentie de toute ma vie aussi libre.
Let's call for the equality. Let's call for justice. Let's save these Muslim women from the oppression of today. So let's free her, please. Free her from what? Free her from her dignity, of course. Free her from the clothes that she wears. Free her from the pride that she has. Free her that she doesn't know who the ancestors were. Let's free this girl. Let's set her free. Come on, girl, come on down. Come on down, who you have no value. Come on down, where your price is for the highest bidder. Come on down, where every time they can hear you, will look at you. Come on down that you'll be judged according to 36:24:36. If you fit the bill, you're good. How big the measurement, how good you look, it's not what you have inside, it's what you have outside. It is a superficial, short-lived, a measuring stick that is judged by a human being. They put you like a hanger. They put the clothes on. This here is red, everybody wears red. This here is black, everybody wears black. It's below the knee, it's above the knee, it's cut from the right, it's cut from the left, cut from the front, cut from the back. You feel like a toy. You're a slave to a man that tells you what to do, what not to do, what to wear, what not to wear. Is that the freedom you're telling me about? Or are you a slave to Allah subhanahu wa jalla fi ula? A man that doesn't care who you are, where you go, you're going to end up in the hellfire after him? Or Allah subhanahu wa jalla fi ula that wants you to go in eternal happiness? Is that the freedom you're telling me about? If this is who you are, It's a choice you have to make, Ukhti. Every successful man needs a Khadija. So the first person to embrace Islam was a woman. The first person to die for Islam was a woman. Sumayya. The greatest scholar of Islam was a woman. Aisha. The person who loved the Prophet the most was a woman. Who was that woman? Fatima. The person who made the biggest sacrifice for Islam in one day was a woman. Hamza. One of the greatest fighters in Islamic history was a woman. Khawla bint al-Aswar. She fought on the back of horses, killed many kuffar, and spurred the mujahideen on to go on.
This evening, inshallah ta'ala, is for every one of our sisters who loves Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that lives in defense of the Quran and the Sunnah, and lives for Jannah, that has forgotten who she is. I want to speak to you, but the real you. I don't want to speak to the lipstick, or the color contacts, or the pink hair, or the loud gum, or the head bouncing to the iPod, or the cowgirl boots, or the fake nails. I want to speak to you, the real you, your heart and your soul and your mind, about those things buried deep down inside of you that I wish that you could remember. Don't you remember who you are? وَنِسَاءٌ كَاسِيَاتٌ عَارِيَاتٌ مَائِلَاتٌ مُمِلَاتٌ. And women that are kasiyat, they have clothes on, they have fabric on their bodies. عَارِيَات, but they're naked. They're wearing clothes, but it's as if they're not wearing anything. Their clothes are offering no concealment for them, like the women we see nowadays. Ma'ilat, mumilat. They sway side to side in the way they walk, the way they talk, and the way they interact with the opposite gender. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, La yadkhulna al-jannah, wa la yajidna rihah. They do not enter Jannah, these two types of people. And they will not even be able to find the fragrance of Jannah. The woman that leave the house with the shape of their bodies defined, or their hair shown, or they are decorated in one way, shape or form, or they are perfumed. Every neck that turns, every eye that looks, you share in the sin of the person that committed it. You can be thinking about a million one things from the moment you leave your house till the moment you return. You can be thinking about school and exams and shopping and email and studying and friends and appointments. You could be upon the bus reading Quran or making dhikr, and you don't even realize it. That guy whose eyes fall on your thigh, or his eyes fall upon your arms or your neck or your waist, or your legs, any of this, you get the exact same sin, because you made that sin a possibility. You made it available. And it appeared to them before Allah what they never expected. Sins and sins and sins and sins, mountains. Never expected it. Some people will come on the Day of Judgment, and this will be their condition. So wallahi, it's not just another sin. Our enemies, the enemies of Allah, the enemies of His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the enemies of the Quran, the enemies of the believing men and women, they tricked the women Muslim and non-Muslim alike, into selling herself like a piece of flesh on the streets. They brainwash the woman into thinking that whatever attention she can draw to herself, that means she's liberated. They did it, for example, with the anti-Islam propaganda. They throw a bunch of women on screen with hijab on, and they say this is the definition of oppression, 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 oppression. And something repeated so many times begins to settle in the minds and taken for granted as a reality and as a fact. Add on top of that, as sociologists will tell you, this is not some random guess, trained specialists and researchers tell you that a woman, when she dresses more provocatively, she gets 14% better wage. The higher the skirt, the higher the pay. The more buttons open on the blouse, the higher the pay. The prettier the hair, the higher the pay. They trick the women into thinking the attention they can grab to what? To feed their perverse desires. They brainwashed women into thinking that was value. And they thought they were liberated. And they finally achieved equality. But I want to say they might have tricked the women. I want to say they might have tricked the women, but not you. Not my sister. Not the slave of Allah. You would not fall for that. You are wiser than that. Sister, my sister, O daughter of Islam. You see, that's who you are. The daughter of Islam. That girl jumping around on screen in the music videos, that's not you. That girl dressed in a business suit, staying late in a private office as someone's secretary, that's not you. That fool on the billboard, that's not you. Sister, O daughter of Islam, become modest. Do not remove the veil. Do not remove the hijab from upon you and then become regretful. Guard your beauty if it's honor that you seek. Because the people around you are like wolves on the prowl. Wallahi, this is so true. They killed in you the most beautiful thing about you. Al-haya, modesty. Sister, O you who spends hours in front of the mirror, looking at herself. Don't you know that Allah is watching you and looking at you as you are sitting there or standing there, pleased at what you are preparing of the disobedience of Allah? O sister who spends such large sums of money at the salon to give herself the new look for the party or the streets or the classroom or the boardwalk, how much would you pay to fix your look before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Sister, wallahi, I fear for you. How many beautiful girls with beautiful skin got tried with skin cancer that is so common in females nowadays? How many beautiful girls had to go through a procedure, an agonizing, depressing, grievous procedure, because she's tried with breast cancer? You think these diseases were always so common? Wallahi, they were not. Not in the age of obedience. I fear for you a punishment to come down from Allah. Veil yourself. And I fear for you that you don't really think you're going to die. Wallahi, you're going to die. We said this many times over and over again. That guy that you turned his neck in the street, wallahi, he will not benefit you when you are on that piece of wood and they are washing your body with that cold water.
That there is no one on this earth more beautiful than a Muslim woman. There's no one who comes close to that, who is a servant of Allah, who dresses to please Allah. Khaliful Mushrikeen, the opposite, the people, the disbelievers. So when this woman, before she leave the house, like the other woman, she looks in the mirror. But they're looking in the mirror for something different.
When the woman in the street look in the mirror, she looking to make sure she has the best style. She looks good. She can attract a man. But this woman, when she look in the mirror, she makes sure she's dressed appropriately. Make sure that Allah is pleased with her. Make sure she's covered. So when she go out in the street, then she covered to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And she does that, she's beautiful. Opposite. The more you grow, the more you study, the more iman you have, the more you become disattracted to some of the things of the dunya. You don't like what you used to do because something happened to you. What happened to you? Something is in my heart now. Something is in my mind. I have Quran in my mind. I have Quran in my heart. I have the love of the Prophet. I have the love of Allah. I have something in me and I'm now different. I feel different. And I warn you, those of you who still like the dunya, and you don't make a distinction, then iman is not written in your heart. And be careful. Be careful. Be careful.
The choice you have to make. So you ask yourself, do you have a life or is it a lifestyle? What do you have on your walls? Who you listen to? Who you look up to? Who you trying to imitate? You walk, talk, eat, dress, everything like. And you'll find out that some of them, unfortunately, go with the flow. That's how I roll. I get the bling bling, I go down. It's true. Why? Because it's the peer pressure of today. And then you'll find out that who I am, that truly am, if you look at the reflection, when you look at yourself in the mirror, you have to think, my grandmother, my ancestors, Khadija. Don't you know who you are, Ukhti? Your ancestors, you are the children, grandchildren of the Aisha, Fatima radiallahu anhum ajma'in. So you should be proud, wallahi, of who you are. Walk with your head up high and think about it. Think about what Islam done. The first indication, go back to Ayyam al-Jahiliyyah, the pre-Islamic era, the ignorant era, so they call it. You'll find out that women had no rights. Women were killed before Islam just because they were dishonorable. It was a shame. As a matter of fact, it is mentioned in the Quran. It was a shame for anyone to have a daughter. What did they do? They either kill it or bury it alive or bear with it for a shameless day or a long life. It is narrated that a man came to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He says, I've done something before Islam that I fear that Allah may not forgive me for that. And of course we know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives all sins except one, which is shirk, ascribing partners unto Allah subhanahu wa jalla fi ula. He told him, after a long story, he says, I had this daughter. I felt ashamed. I was patient for a few years. And after a while, I made a decision that I will either bury her or throw her in the well. And as I've done, I hear my daughter say, you have killed me, Dad. And I waited for her voice to drown till I heard her die. Till Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam cried and the people around him cried too. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals, وَإِذَا الْمَوْءُودَةِ سُئِلَتْ بِأَيِّ ذَنْبٍ قُتِلَتْ. On judgment day, this ma'uda, this young child, this young daughter that's prior to Islam, what sin has it committed for it to die? What mistake has she done? By what right have you killed your own daughters? She will come on judgment day, ask you, what sin have I done to be killed? What right have you had over me to kill me? So this was the first indication that Islam honored women. You go back in history, you'll find that Islam gave a woman the right to inherit, gave a right to a woman to have business. All these are authenticated. that Islam has given women way over, not just 100 years or so ago that they were fighting and debating. Over 1400 years ago, Islam given that the rights of women. Imagine yourself, Akhi and Ukhti. And you go back in history, you'll find out that their own faith says the same thing. You go back in the scriptures, you'll find the authenticated ones actually telling you the same thing. Amazing. Islam says no, women are honored. Women are honored. We look at them much more than you think. They're elevated. The only religion on the face of the earth that elevated mothers over three times over the father. No other religion on the face of the earth that actually honors women more than Islam. If you think about it, you'll find Islam is the only true path. It teaches you that even when you go ask for your hand in marriage, a wife, she's still wearing the hijab. Why? Because you don't look at that, what we talked about before. You look at her mind. You look at her characteristics, her personality, heart, the religion background, the moral conduct background. Not the other way around where they meet in bars. If she's good or round or she takes her whatever, I'm trying to keep this a family show as much as possible. We have kids, how old are you, son? You get the gist, you understand what I'm saying. Allah help you, wallahi. But of course the sisters have it very difficult. You think it's easy? La wallahi. But you tell me, man, I wear a thobe. Man, I have a beard. No, no. You try wearing a hijab and niqab and walk down the street just in case you think it's easy. Wallahi, it's not easy. They are a walking pulpit, ya akhi. You should be proud, ufti. It's a izzah, it's an honor for you to be a Muslim muhajjaba. Wallahi. You stick out like everybody else is walking naked and you're holding on. Even though it's hot in the sun, the scholars say every drop of sweat in your body is the heaviest on the scale. You've shaded yourself here, Allah will shade you on Judgment Day, where there's no shade except His shade. 50,000 years. Imagine yourself, this is a true story, a young girl was wearing the hijab, another sister, supposed to be Muslim. She says, isn't it hot? What did she say? قُلْ نَارُ جَهَنَّمْ أَشَدُّ حَرَّى. The hellfire is hotter. Imagine yourself, أختي عفيفة, honorable. No one sees you except what is permitted to be seen, or those who can see you. Imagine yourself, أختي, as if you're the only one that is fighting. When the whole army is fled, you're the only one holding on to La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah, in an environment that is full of mischief, transgression, evil deeds and acts. Imagine yourself, Ukhti, being resurrected on pulpits of light, being proud to say La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah, when everybody else around you has not. Imagine, ya Ukhti, you're called Al-Qaleel, you're amongst the few. وَقَلِيلٌ مِنْ عِبَادِيَ الشَّكُورِ. May Allah make us among the qaleel, the few, ameen. Only a few of my slaves are grateful. And how could you be grateful? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you the answer, وَعْمَلُوا آلَ دَاوُدَ شُكْرًا. It's the amal, it's the actions and deeds. So once you wear the hijab, ukhti, Allahu Akbar. Imagine yourself, the honor when you walk around. Nobody will be able to see you and say, she's walking for this, she's looking for that. But we take the norm or the general, inshaAllah, understanding the iffah, the honor and the dignity of that woman by the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we go back and say, don't be fooled, ukhti. Don't be fooled when they tell you, like some other women done in another country, again so-called Muslim. They took off their hijab, placed it beneath their feet, and they start stomping on it, declaring it's the freedom of women now. Allahu Akbar. And everyone that followed her, she will commit that sin till judgment day. Could you imagine? The scholars will tell you, for every hair that is shown to a non-mahram, to a person that can actually marry you, is considered a sin. You imagine now if the sister is not muhajjaba, for every hair on her head is counted as a sin. You do how many people have seen you without, multiply by the days of your life, you do the math. Subhanallah. Don't you see this sister that's walking around, especially in the West, that's wearing the hijab or the niqab, like an angel? Wallahi, I've never had so much respect for women till I've seen a sister that is walking in the West, especially, that is wearing a hijab or niqab. Wallahi, she looks like an angel walking down. Ya Allah, subhanaka rabbi. By the izzah. And some now, the Muslim sister says, I don't want to be known, ya akhi. It's a difficult time, different this and different that. Says, you're going against the Quran, ya ukhti. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لِكَيْ يُعْرَفْنُ فَلَا يُؤْذَيْنُ لِكَيْ يُعْرَفْنُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you wear this so you will be known. You will be known so you will not be harmed. How could you be known? I am not that type of a girl. That's a declaration. I'm a Muslim woman. Don't mess with me. Where is the pearl come from? The beauty of the pearl is inside the shell. The shell may not look that beautiful, but what's inside that counts. That is the beauty of the woman in Muslims. As the Muslim woman, the beauty of your ukhti is who you are, who you truly are, what you're created for, the reason that is inside your heart. The beauty under the hijab, not the outside, the fake. When you take that sister that looks like a whatever, you take her, you put her under a shower, you take her out, you take all that paint and all that plastic and all that stuff, she looks like a sallallahu alaihi wa sallam. But the beauty, the one that worships Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fi ula, no matter what, you actually admire and respect that sister. The sister that will be with you in heaven, inshallah, is totally different. So even the brothers, they may be fooled. They have the picture in the back of their mind that this is who I want to marry. That's beauty. That's love. But don't you see, ya akhi, look at all the dreams before and even nations before, you'll find out that hijab was before Islam. When people tell you that a Muslim woman is oppressed and they had to be forced to do this, I said, you don't even know, you haven't done your own homework. You go back to the nations before you, I asked him one question, what was the color of the hair of Mary, may peace be upon her, the mother of Jesus, may peace be upon her. What was her hair color? They don't know. They tell me, I have heard this. Brown, black, blonde. I have heard this blue. Blue, come on, man. It's not from Mars. We're coming down to Earth, dude. Come on. This is from the schools that come to the center and they talk about comparative religion and the world religion classes. I go, you know why you don't know? Because she was what? You tell me, yes, she was covered. You're right. What about the nuns? Yeah, it's covered too. So, okay, let's free the nuns. Free the nuns, man. Free Mary. Let's go do the demonstration in the streets. I tell you, let's go too quickly now. What were you thinking? We oppress women, we force them to wear the hijab? I go, on the contrary. This is a European country. You're supposed to be at the top of democracy, a G7. Freedom, democracy in action. They passed the law that you cannot cover your head. They passed the law, you cannot cover your head. Now they're passing other laws that you cannot cover even your face and so on. And they say that's a democracy. They tell you what to do, what not to do, how to live your life, and how to what to worship, what not to worship, how to actually practice your religion, and they call that a democracy? Allahu Akbar. In France, after they passed that law, who walked in the streets of France asking for the rights to wear the hijab? Was it Muslim men? Was it Muslim men going, we want to oppress our women? Let them put our hijab on. No, it was Muslim women that walked in the streets of France asking for the rights to wear the hijab. It was French women that walked in the streets of France to support Muslim women for their own rights. Let them be. But hold on to La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. Because that is your lifeline. Wallahi. This time is short-lived. However, my sisters in Islam, I can't tell you how proud I am of you, wallahi, of holding on to the hijab or the niqab here in the West. It's a struggle day in, day out. But what gets this poor slave of Allah is when I hear a sister on the other line crying. Says, my father will disown me if I wear the hijab. I said, I'm sorry, Ukhti, repeat that, please. So my father will disown me if I wear the hijab. He says, if you wear the hijab, I will disown you. Or better yet, my husband now is telling me to take the hijab off. I go, Allahu Akbar. I can't believe I'm hearing those words with my own ears. Have you not heard, ya akhi, that in Jannah there is a banner that says, la yadkhuliki the youth. The youth, the definition. مَنْ يَرَى الْقُبْحَ عَلَىٰ أَهْلِهِ وَيَرْضَى بِهِ. Those who see that is unlawful upon their women folks, the one they're in charge of, or responsible for, and he accepts that. As a matter of fact, you go the other way around. Tighten the dress a bit, shorten a little more, take up the hijab, show a little bit of whatever, and all that stuff. Imagine, or they ask her to do something that is bad or unlawful, or haram, la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. That is called the youth. On Judgment Day, there is a banner in the heaven says, this the youth will not be permitted to enter heaven. So my brothers in Islam, be very careful, ya akhi. So the Khadijas of today, and the Aishas of today, are brought up in a way that they can understand what the true Islam is all about. People are the product of the society, the environment around you, aid you in doing what you're doing or helping you to believe what you believe. So what I'm asking you, akhi and ukhti, is to raise them in the righteous environment, to have the righteous friends, the infrastructure are raised early. That's why Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Muru awladakum lis-salati lis-sab'." Command them to pray at 7 years old. Not when they reach puberty or the other age of 15. No, it's too late then. The scholar says qiyas, analogy. Do the same thing with the hijab, akhi and ukhti. Link them. So if your daughters are raised in a way to know what Islam is about and what the beauty of the hijab and the reward, at 7 years old you start. Don't ask them, let them be around the righteous company. Choose the righteous spouse for them. Meaning the mother is the example, that's the one that teaches them. So what I'm telling you, to be proactive, not reactive, ya akhi. They're children that have rights upon you before they're even created. That's another topic. But that's how they're raised, my brother. And the infrastructure of having a good friend. You have no choice of your family, but you certainly have choice of your friends. So three criteria you look for, ukhti, in order for you to hold on. To be resurrected with Aisha and Khadija, inshaAllah, ameen. If you see them, they remind you of Allah. If you see them, they'll remind you of the path to that Jannah, inshaAllah, to the path, the straight path of Allah. Zadaka iman al mantiqu. When they speak, your iman increases. They remind you about heaven, hell, life, death. If you find that, ukhti, hold on to them. And I tell you, ukhti, you are our sister, our mother, our daughter, our wife. You are the core of this ummah. You are the backbone of this ummah. So that's the reason we tell you, we honor you. That's why Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave us the advice before he dies. Look after women, look after women, look after women. Why? Over 1400 years ago, he realized that our enemies will come through Islam through the gate of women. They will start ruining them, giving these ideas about freedom. So he says, look after women. They're the ones that are going to use or raise the youth. They're the ones that are going to raise your children. They're the ones that will teach. They're the ones that are the core of the ummah. Why? Because the ummah have made of countries. And the countries have made of communities. And the communities are made of families. And the core of the family is the mother, whether you like it or not. She's the one that looks after you and looks after your children. So we have to look after them, my brothers and sisters. So what I ask you new now, brothers. You need to tell your wife, I love you. At least 3 times a day. Look after your woman, ya akhi. That's the advice of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So when the enemies come and say you're detested or you're oppressed, they say, no, I am honored, I am loved, I am respected, I am raised and honored and elevated. Yes, dignified. Why? Because Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us that. He used to declare, he says, رُزِقْتُ حُبَّهَا. I was blessed by her love. The best of us declared his love, ya akhi. So when you go, I'm not going to tell you what to do with your wife, that's another course. But you can understand, wallahi. You can understand when Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, ummak thumma ummak thumma ummak thumma abak. Allahu Akbar. Your mother, your mother, your mother, then your father. Isn't that enough? So my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, leaving you with one thing. That woman in your life, whether it's your mother, your daughter, your sister, or your wife, is the only creation on the face of the earth that will go hungry in order for you to be eaten, to be fed. She will go thirsty in order for you to quench your thirst. She'll have sleepless nights so you can have the comfort of the sleep zone. She will sacrifice her life in order for you to live. She will laugh when she sees you laugh. She will cry when she sees you cry. She devoted her life in order for you to stand on your own feet. You'll find out that who you are is because of your own mother. It's because of the woman behind you. You'll find out that they are the reason, the second reason of creation. So you understand now who the woman in Islam is. The rights they have and the honor they have and the love and respect they have in our heart and soul. From now on, ya akhi, when you see this sister walking around in hijab and niqab, you make dua for her. You ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give her thabat. You ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give her Jannah, Firdaus al-A'la. You ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to resurrect her with Khadija, with Aisha radiallahu anhum ajma'een. You ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant them for their patience and struggle and strive to be drinking from Hawd al-Kawthar on Judgment Day. You ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to shade them on Judgment Day where there's no shade except His shade. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to shade us on Judgment Day where there's no shade except His shade. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be able to help our sisters to hold on and being righteous and give them the support they need, especially out here in the West, and make dua for them all the time. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless them all. Wa akhir da'wahum alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen wa sallam ala alihi wa sahbihi wa tabi'in. Jazakumullah khayr wa salamu alaykum.
Quand satisfait Dieu, c'est ça le plus important pour nous. Le regard des autres, c'est pas le plus important. Ils seront pas là le jour qu'on va mourir. Ils seront pas là le jour de la résurrection, quand on sera tous devant notre Seigneur.
The messenger of Allah, waged war against Banu Qaynuqa for the sake of one Muslim woman. Defender. This tells you how